the professor profess. And that's an important, not that you ever hear that at home, of course, but I think it's one of those most important things. It's a rite of passage and an absolutely wonderful occasion. So now I just want to make one or two housekeeping announcements. In case of load shedding, it's unlikely that load shedding will occur, but I just want to remind you, I'm the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Systems and Operations. They make me run these events so that when the lights go out, you know exactly where to point your finger. But in the unlikely event that in fact we do have load shedding, just hold on to somebody close to you and just remain calm until we're ready to go again. Without any further ado, Professor Shabir Muddy, can I ask you to please step up and introduce our inaugurating professor? Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. General, and good evening, guests and our main speaker. So I meant to introduce Prof. Joanne Potterton. However, I face a challenge, and the challenge that I face is as I walked in and asked for a bio sketch, I realized that her bio sketch is fairly rudimentary, and it really speaks to the topic that she's going to discuss. So rather, I'm going to ad lib. I'm fortunate enough in that I've actually known Joanne when I was actually training as a pediatrician, way back in 1993, 1994, at which time I think she was still a joint staff member. She was at Gauteng Department of Health, very much involved in care of children, obviously, and particularly children with cerebral palsy, and if I recollect, in the neonatal ward. And certainly my recall from those days was a very caring person, and someone that was always wanting to be involved in the management of children and of the neonates, and certainly made a huge difference in terms of the well-being of those children that she looked after. But beyond that, she moved on to the School of Physiology at Wits University, and since then has obviously rapidly progressed in terms of her academic career. And today she's going to be giving a lecture in recognition of her full professorship, and the title of the lecture is Positive Childhood Growing Up with HIV in South Africa. So Joanne, I'm not going to read what is around except to say congratulations and welcome.
Good evening, Professor General, Professor Muddy, Professor Maezwa, colleagues, friends, and family. It's a great honor to be here tonight, and I think few people realize how nerve-wracking a lecture like this is, and everybody keeps saying, but you do it all the time, and it's what you do every day. Don't panic, but I can promise you I'm panicking more than I have for a long time. Before I begin this evening, I think it's just important to note that nothing I speak about this evening and none of the achievements that are attributed to me over the years are mine alone. I've worked as part of a team and a growing team from those very early days at Baragwanath. So to begin with, to say thank you to the people who have mentored me and helped me to get where I am today. And I start with Gillian Saluji and Professor John Rodder, who were my mentors and inspired me so much when I worked at Baragwanath. And at that stage, I never realized how their passion and their expertise would carry me forward for the next 30 plus years. Working at WITS, I've had a number of mentors and colleagues, both in physiotherapy but also in pediatrics, who have really supported me every step of the way. So to Professors M.A. Stewart, Helen Miezwa, Peter Cooper, Daniel Ballett, and Ashraf Kuvadia, I owe a huge vote of thanks as well. And then to my postgraduate students, many of whom are here tonight. The master's students, I think too many to mention, but all of them have helped me to further my own passion for what I do. And then in particular, my PhD students, whose names you will see on the presentations tonight, whose work has really contributed to what we know about pediatric HIV. So to Nicole, Renata, Natalie, and Nikki, thank you very much for everything that you've brought. to me. And then on a personal note, I need to acknowledge my parents and my siblings. I think they gave me the blueprint for what a positive childhood should look like. And really, I wouldn't be here this evening without them. But most of all, to the wonderful children in our family, to Adam, Rebecca, and Sarah, but also all my nephews and nieces, Jacob and Christopher, Georgia, Connor, Benjamin and Kira, and Sam, you continue to be the gold standard of what normal, healthy, mostly happy children should look like. And you intrigue and amaze and inspire me on a daily basis. So I think the question that people often ask and that I've had to think about myself often is, why HIV? And with so many things and so many health concerns, how did I end up working in this particular field and spending 20 years of my life researching pediatric HIV? And it did all start at Barragwanath, and I think in all honesty, FOMO was a huge part of it. I had colleagues like Shabi Mahdi and Glenda Gray getting incredibly involved in the HIV pandemic from very early days. I could see children coming into the wards. We had limited testing, we had no treatment, and those children who didn't die immediately were often readmitted time and time again. And there was no information about the role of physiotherapy and no indication of where we would possibly be involved. I then worked at a rural hospital for a year where there was no testing, and there certainly was no treatment for the children, but the children were being admitted, and we could see, or I could see, that there was a potential role for physiotherapy. And then coming back to WITS and being encouraged quite firmly to do a master's, it seemed obvious to me what the topic should be. This photograph also appeared in the Sunday Times, and these two little boys lived at Cotlin's orphanage. They're twins, or they were twins. And it's very obvious, just looking at them, to see what the effect of HIV was on infants who were infected. And so, very early on in my research career, I decided that this was a route that I had to take. I think we can't talk about HIV without talking about a little bit of statistics, but due to limited time, and I can happily say that because on my part, limited expertise in epidemiology, I won't go into detail, but I think if one looks at a world mapper map, which distorts the world map relative to the prevalence of a disease, you can see how sub-Saharan Africa is absolutely magnified, and countries like Australia and New Zealand practically disappear. So looking at this, there's no doubt in any, or should be no doubt in anybody's mind, that HIV remains a huge problem, and particularly for Africa. When we look at some statistics related particularly to children, again, if you look at the numbers around the world, you can see that the vast majority of children living with HIV are living in sub-Saharan Africa. And South Africa holds the dubious record of hosting the biggest number of HIV positive children in the world. I think when we look at these numbers, and particularly related to children living with HIV, we can understand why there was so little information coming from the rest of the world to guide us in what the role of a physiotherapist might possibly be. It's not America's problem, it's not Europe's problem, it's not Australia's problem. And those are the countries where we typically look to for clinical guidelines or treatment ideas. So this picture has persisted for a number of years, but it was obvious to me that as South African physios, we would have to step up and generate this information for ourselves. If we take a quick look at what is happening in South Africa and look at stats over the last 13 years or so, you can see that for children, the number of new infections has dropped considerably. So from 39,000 in 2010 down to 10,000 in 2021. At the same time, AIDS-related deaths in these children has also dropped considerably. And this is a direct reflection of our improving access to antiretroviral therapy. The number of children living with HIV is fairly consistent, and that's because although we have far fewer children being infected with HIV, we also have far fewer children dying of HIV. So that number has stayed reasonably constant. The World Health Organization has put a target forward that by 2025, 95% of people living with, or 95% of people should know their HIV status, 95% of those who know their status should be on treatment, and 95% of those on treatment should be virally suppressed. If we look at the stats for South Africa, for 2022 stats, 83% of children 0 to 14 know their status. Only 48% of those are on antiretroviral therapy, even though policy is that every child should have access as soon as their diagnosis is known. And of those children who are on antiretroviral therapy, only 33% were currently suppressed. So there is a global concern that although there have been enormous gains made in terms of access to treatment, that these gains are being eroded by the conflicting demands of natural disasters caused by global warming and COVID, conflicting for attention in the media, but also for funding in terms of research. So we certainly cannot yet take our eye off the ball and assume that we've got HIV under control and that we're going to continue on the trajectory that we were on. David, nothing happening? My colleagues will tell you that if something can glitch with technology, it will happen to me. I didn't touch it. The technical expert. Yeah, I don't mind.
Everything's frozen.
Just when I was on a roll. Seem to be back on track. I did nothing, I promise. All right, so HIV affects multiple systems of the body, and one of the first things that we became interested in was the development of very young children infected by HIV. The first time that I proposed a project looking at developmental delay in children who were HIV positive, one of my colleagues, not a physio's response was, why bother? The children are all dead by the time they're two. Okay? Not all of them were dead by the time they were two, and I thought that it was worth bothering about the ones who were living to two and beyond. So HIV is neurotrophic and can cross the immature blood-brain barrier very easily, which results in a devastating encephalopathy and severe developmental delay if not treated. In our early studies that we did, we found that up to 75% of the infants who we assessed presented with severe developmental delay across all facets of development, but particularly for gross motor development. The children who we were seeing were not on antiretroviral therapy, and they were also showing signs of severe malnutrition. They were wasted and stunted, and many of them were extremely ill. As access to antiretroviral therapy started improving, so this picture began to change a bit. We were still seeing 60% of children presenting with developmental delay, but it was not nearly as severe. And what was apparent as well was that the earlier the children started antiretroviral therapy, the better the outcome was. Being physios, we couldn't just sit and count numbers, we had to do something. So we started with a randomized control trial early in 2023, when access to antiretrovirals was still negligible, where we looked to see whether implementing a very basic home stimulation program, which we taught to the children's caregivers, whether that could make a difference to their developmental outcomes. I remember halfway through the trial thinking, how stupid. These children have so much going wrong in their lives. Their mothers are ill, the children are ill. How could a developmental program make a difference? And yet it did. To both cognitive and motor development, we saw a significant difference in the children who participated in the program compared to those who didn't. And I think of equal importance to us was that we saw a reduction in parenting stress of the caregivers whose children were given the program. And I remember one young mom saying to me during the trial, you're the first person who's spoken to me as though my baby has a future and that I can do something to help her. And I think that was very meaningful for us. The program we initially had was based on individual assessment and tailored to meet the needs of each child, which required that you had to have a physio present who could do that and could assess the children and monitor their progress. So we then went on later to institute another program where we developed a standardized program and the children would get little, or the caregivers would get little information cards every 3 months with activities that they could try with their children at home. We also provided them with a plastic box, and every 3 months they would be given a new toy or book or something to do with their babies at home. And again, we found that the children who participated in the program did considerably better than those who did not. We also realized that the developmental outcome measures that we were using were incredibly expensive and time-consuming and required a lot of expertise to administer. Most of our HIV clinics around the country don't have physios, or if they do have a physio, it might be a community service physio or a physio with very little pediatric experience. So we went on to develop a screening tool which would be freely available, easy to administer, would require no equipment and no special expertise, so that this could be done not only by junior physios, but also by nursing staff or community rehab workers working in the area. we tested the tool and it does have very good psychometric properties, and the uptake has been fairly good around the country. Over time, we realized that there was a growing concern about the children who we were using as our control group in our studies. And a control group or comparator group is supposed to be the gold standard, or children who are developing well. But we realized that there was increasing worry about children who were exposed to HIV in utero, but were not HIV positive themselves. So what is the effect of being a fetus growing up in utero when your mom is taking highly toxic antiretroviral drugs? Although we know they're incredibly effective, they're not without side effects. What was the impact of that on the developing baby, as well as the impact of being in utero in a host who has chronic inflammation due to her own HIV infection? And I think this is an area where the jury is still out, and a lot of research needs to be done. We certainly find that our HIV-exposed, uninfected infants don't do as badly as the HIV-positive infants, but they don't do as well as the HIV-unexposed, uninfected infants. So they're sitting in between the two groups, and preliminary studies have shown, particularly in later years, so sort of the preschool age, that cognitive and speech development, especially expressive language, is delayed in these infants. They're also often underweight and of short stature, despite being relatively healthy. So our babies were growing up and starting to reach the age where they were going to preschool and definitely living longer, healthier lives already. We did, however, find that many of the caregivers, when they came to the clinic, would report that the children were struggling at school and struggling at preschool, and that the teachers complained that they were behind. So we shifted our age range up a bit and started to look at children up to the age of 5. When we assessed these infants, we found that still over half of them presented with significant delay. But the facets of development that were affected were now slightly different to what we had seen in our very young infants who presented with gross motor delay. Now we were seeing more delays related to speech, cognition, and visual perception. And you can imagine how important those are for a child who's preparing to go to school. So we realized that we had to look broader than our physio gross motor approach, and certainly needed more input from speech therapists, occupational therapists, and educational psychologists as these children moved forward. And I always liked this little picture that one of the children drew for us on their draw a person category. It is, however, a picture drawn by a child of nearly 5. So we probably would want a little more than that by age 5. We also began to look at older children. So for this study, we looked at children, I can still see, which is fine. So for this study, we looked at children who were attending the HIV clinic at Rahima Musa Mother and Child Hospital. And we did a very basic disability screening assessment based using the 10-question disability screen, which is widely used around the world and developed by the World Health Organization. When we did this study, we soon picked up that of the children attending the clinic, over 50% presented with at least one disability. Of those, only 40% had ever been referred for any form of rehabilitation. So this was at a hospital where we knew the doctors and they knew us, and we knew that there were physios and OTs and speech therapists working at the hospital, and still the children were falling through the cracks. So that was of great concern to us, that even when services are available, the children are not accessing them in time. Should I wait or carry on? Carry on. Frozen. Next one. All right, so this slide was with the children from 2 to 10 years of age, and you can see again here that the type of disability that we're seeing in these slightly older children has changed again, that although general developmental delay remained the most common type of disability we were seeing, speech delays and communication and behavior delays were becoming very common as well. Next slide, please. Okay, at about this time, we were again presenting at an assessors meeting, and the comment came from one of the assessors, the children are fine, they're all on antiretroviral therapy, stop looking for problems. Okay. Any decent parent knows that when your child gets into the car after a long day and you say, how was your day? And they say, it was fine. Mm-hmm. That's exactly when you start asking more questions. So we did. We looked at motor function in a group of children with a more comprehensive motor assessment, and this study was done at Tambo Memorial Hospital, and found that again, 60% of 5 to 10 year olds who participated in the study had motor delay. What was interesting to note was that girls were more likely to present with muscle weakness, and emotional functioning when we assessed quality of life was also low. We know from studies around the world and across all sorts of different fields that physical activity in girls is of incredible concern, and particularly as they start reaching the pre-puberty years. So it was interesting to note that already such a high proportion of our young girls were presenting with muscle weakness, which might prevent them from participating in physical activity as they grew older. Next. So muscle strength and endurance are things that are well documented in adults living with HIV, and we knew for sure that muscle weakness and endurance are problems in adults living with HIV. But when we looked at the literature, there were conflicting reports about whether children living with HIV were at risk for decreased muscle strength and endurance, with some studies saying, yes, they are at risk, and others saying they're doing really well. We looked at over 175 children living with HIV and compared them to their HIV negative peers, and found no significant difference between the muscle strength and endurance of these two groups. What was interesting though was that both groups compared very poorly to international norms. So perhaps this study told us more about our control group and about the health and well-being of children living in our townships in general than just about our HIV-positive children. The children in our studies had also all initiated antiretroviral therapy relatively early in their lives. They were all on ART and were virally suppressed. So they were the cream of the crop They were well looked after and well monitored. And when we looked and compared our results to, or our population to the reports that were showing that the children had decreased muscle strength or poor endurance, we found that those children, that the children in those studies had generally initiated antiretroviral therapy a lot later, after diagnosis, and that their viral loads were not well controlled. So again, we had evidence pointing towards the early initiation of antiretroviral therapy being protective of physical performance later on. Next one. So in the world of HIV, adolescents really have been the missing middle. We had a growing body of evidence of how the children were doing, infants and young children, and there's certainly a lot of literature about how adults were doing, but there was nothing on adolescents. And Prof. Miezwa was continually pushing me to say, look at the adolescents, look at the adolescents. And I would say, no, they're not real children. I don't want to move into that age range. However, there were a number of reports that were reporting on neurocognitive and behavioral aspects, and very few studies on the physical effects of perinatally acquired HIV in adolescents. So like all good senior researchers, when you have an important question that needs addressing and you don't want to address it, you find a PhD student. Next, please. So Nikki Comley-White took on the adolescent studies, and to begin with, we really needed to find out what was happening with the adolescents, because there certainly wasn't a lot of evidence around. When she did a scoping review, she found that poor growth, decreased levels of physical activity, and decreased endurance had been reported in a few studies from around the world, but very few. Next slide, please. She then went on to do a qualitative study, because if we want to know what problems adolescents are experiencing, surely one of the first things we should do is ask them, because adolescents always have an opinion. So through her qualitative study, where she interviewed children from 10 to 19 years of age, they reported that they had poor endurance, experienced pain, fatigue, had muscle weakness, and poor motor skills. These impairments impacted negatively on their ability to participate in their normal functional activities. Going to school, playing sports, on the dance floor, were all impacted by these problems. Although it wasn't part of what we were looking for, they also reported having cognitive issues, dizziness, nausea, and mental health concerns. So based on what the little bit of literature had told us and what the adolescents had told us, next slide please, we put together a battery of tests to test what the functional status of adolescents were, and assessed over 200 children, or young people. And apart from endurance, the adolescents with HIV scored significantly lower than their uninfected peers on all measures of physical functioning, including things like muscle strength and coordination, as well as for levels of fatigue, disability, and quality of life. Next slide, please. Nikki then went on to develop a model of care, which is schematically presented here. And that really shows, with the adolescent as the center, how we can move outwards looking at their problems and then who we need on the team to address these. And I think the more research we've done, the more we've realized that no one of us as healthcare providers can address all the problems ourselves, and that really a multidisciplinary and in fact interprofessional team is required to be able to meet the needs of these children. Next. So now what? We know that the children in our care are definitely living longer, but with the consequences of living with a chronic disease. Many of them are fine, But most still experience developmental and physical challenges of varying degrees. We need to think about the next generation of children. What about the children who are being born to mothers who have been HIV positive their whole lives? And what about the children who are HIV exposed but uninfected? So we still need to do a lot of work around that. We've learned a lot over the years about how HIV impacts the development and physical functioning of children. But we need to be able to translate that knowledge into policy and that policy into practice. We've had some limited success with getting developmental screening as part of our national policy in the management of children with infants with HIV. But that hasn't extended to screening for disability in the young children and adolescents living with HIV. And it's always of concern to note that although we know developmental stimulation works and some of the other programs that we've had, that we don't see it happening in practice, that we still do not have physiotherapists or occupational therapists or speech therapists working as a fully fledged member of the team in pediatric HIV clinics. And we're relying on the doctors to pick up problems and refer the children to us. It's not their job, and it's not their level of expertise always. So we're missing many, many children who could be benefiting from rehabilitation who are not being picked up in the system. We also see that we need an intersectoral approach. It's not just about healthcare. The children are malnourished, they're not doing well at school, they have numerous psychosocial problems. And if we don't address it from a holistic point of view, then we're going to see very minimal changes across time. Next slide, please. So the time has come for us to take responsibility for our success and make sure that the children in our care not only survive, but thrive. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Potterton, and clearly your apprehension on giving the talk wasn't without substance. I think IT had second guess putting up the challenges, but the way that you've navigated all of the IT challenges makes you worthy of the title of full professor. I really believe that one of the issues that you do highlight is the importance of intersectorial engagement in patient care, and it's something we probably don't recognize sufficiently. And as I indicated when I introduced you, that's something which I can really recognize as being part of your passion, given your experience, not just with the research that you've undertaken in children living with HIV and HIV-exposed children, but also when it came to clinical care. So once again, congratulations. At this stage, I would like to call upon Prof. Helen Mayizwa to deliver a vote of thanks. Prof. Mayizwa is a professor and the head of School of Therapeutic Sciences at the Faculty of Health Sciences at Wits University. She has held several leadership positions in both clinical practice and academic setting. And she probably comes from the opposite end of the spectrum in terms of her research interests, in that she's an expert in HIV and disability and amongst adults, where she has conducted one of the first studies to define the extent of HIV disability in the African setting. So Prof. Mayizwa and Prof. Potterton have worked together for many years and have collaborated on a number of projects involving HIV. Together, the work covers the entire lifespan, as you can see, of people living with HIV. Prof. Mayizwa is therefore well placed to deliver the vote of thanks.
I'm very glad I don't have a PowerPoint. but it gives me great pleasure to be the one that Joe chose to give the vote of thanks. You know, as a colleague, a friend, and a collaborator, thank you, Joe, and congratulations on delivering your inaugural speech, irrespective of, you know, Africa always wins in the end, no matter how much you prepare. They were here early, they were testing the system, but it still, you know, gave you a few challenges. But nonetheless, as Prof. Madi said, you did a fantastic job of it. You know, Joe, Prof. Potterton has been at WITS for nearly 30 years. That's older than some of you in the room. And I joined WITS 18 years ago. And that was not the first time I met Joe. A few years before, I had been delivering a workshop, and she was one of the participants. And so it was lovely to reconnect with Joe in the physiotherapy department. But Prof. Joe, which I'm going to call her for officialdom today, is the mother hen of the department. And I say that from my time as head of department. She's also the Chief Justice. She doesn't know that, because she will raise issues that she thinks are not right, even when everybody else finds them uncomfortable to talk about. She's the historian now taking over from Prof. Amos Stewart, who was the longest serving member. And another nice opposite, which I must say, because Prof. Madi looked at her bio and mine and said, but yours is longer than Joe's. I said, that's typical. Joe has got the propensity to be able to write things in such a brief manner that most of the time I'd run to her and say, how do I shorten this? So that's not surprising, Prof. Madi. But once again, congratulations, Joe. But Joe, as on a personal note, has an extremely dry sense of humor, and I was always the one who got the joke and would laugh. So I think put her and Ian together, and I think we would have an interesting afternoon. But I know that she's one of the few people I know who lights up the most when she sees the under 12s and twinkles in delight in the company of the under 2s. I don't know what that says about her. But let me stick to my, you know, my mandate this afternoon and say thank you to Joe's family for allowing us to spend more time with Joe than you have. Although I can tell you, in any time we had, we knew what was happening with Adam, with Rebecca, and with Sarah. And it's actually quite scary that we saw Sarah, you know, in a bassinet. And she's here tonight listening to her mother in her for her inaugural speech. But Mark, thank you very much for being there to support Joe and allowing her to be Joe, and especially to her children. You are her absolute pride and joy. Thank you very much to the head of department, Prof. Nsia, and the rest of the team who are here to support Joe. I can say with certainty that this team works like a team, because I have the advantage of being the head of school and can look from a different angle. So congratulations to the team for your colleague and friend and the support that you give her. Prof. General, thank you for always being there for the Faculty of Health Sciences. And I look forward to your quips and have a good input of my good endorphins when I've spent time with you. Prof. Madi, thank you very much for being here tonight. And I know that Wednesday is an extremely busy day for you, so I appreciate that you are here, and on behalf of Prof. Potterton, thank you for being here. And Joe mentioned many people who are in the room today and said thank you to each one of you for being here and for taking the time. Driving to WITS University between 4 and 6 is an absolute sacrifice. So. Thank you. I think, Prof. Jandral, maybe we should change the time that we do inaugural lectures. but really, thank you very much. And let me, mention particularly Prof. Stewart, because I think many of us from the physiotherapy world were nurtured by Prof. Stewart, who's sitting in the room, and she was Joe's PhD supervisor. So thank you very much. If I don't mention your name, and Joe mentioned it, you know yourselves, Gillian Saluji, John Rudder, and others that she mentioned. Thank you for being here tonight, and to all her students. At my last count, and Prof. Nsia can probably tell me more correctly, but at my last count, Joe had supervised over 25 master's students, and only, she says, over 50. Well, I said at my last count, so I'm not the one who should keep an eye, it should be Prof. Nsia. But she has supervised, and I think having looked in the faculty, probably has been the person who has supervised the highest number of master's students. Part of the reason for that is that there are not many physiotherapy departments that offer pediatrics at a specialization level. So therefore, most people who want to specialize in pediatric rehabilitation come to WITS University and come to Professor Joe Potterton. So she has become a household name. And I know that she gave a very brief introduction of herself, but she has been invited to many international groups who are now looking at pediatric HIV, and particularly the development of screening tools and programs. So if you look, I think the only area where our statistics in HIV are not declining, as Joe said, is in children living with HIV, and that's the same with adults as well. And this is a great thing because, you know, from a time when you would walk into a ward and the child you saw yesterday is no longer there, to a time where you can actually follow a child through right to the time they go to school, it is absolutely heartwarming to be able to live through that period and to see the development of science and of medicine and translating into a situation where you can look after people's quality of life. And therefore, what this has done, especially for those of us who work in rehabilitation, is that it opens the door for the need for us to pay attention to morbidity, which is what Joe has shown in the pediatric world, and not only at mortality. And this was the very essence of Joanne's message. It is wonderful to see the trajectory of her work, commencing with a better understanding across the spectrum of children. You know, I remember the first time we had a chat about children, I thought, gee, there's a real diversity in the way you can describe the different populations, and you heard it for yourself. The research has been done in neonates, in children who are under the age of two, infants, young children who are going to school, children who are exposed but uninfected, and finally, the adolescents. We had many years of academic banter about that. And I think Joe has shown us the myriad of problems that do exist. And I think if one looks at the importance of quality of life, it is not enough for a child to just get up and walk. It is more important that a child gets up and truly develops. And following on, she has shown us how one can measure these problems in a way that is believable. I think Joe and I went to a meeting once, and somebody did ask us, why should we believe you? Your populations are too small. And this is part of the reason that stimulated further research into looking at research that is believable and has integrity. And following on, I think Joe has shown us how her team and her students have tested interventions, and also not forgetting that when dealing with children, you have a milieu of stakeholders, the parents, the family, the caregivers. There are many papers I am aware of that obviously she could not show you today. that have looked into how to support the broader society that actually contributes to success in treating children. And finally, I want to say that although Joe emphasized the need to translate knowledge, there has been some translation, and she was very humble about, you know, how much they've done. And I do know that in the UN and at the National AIDS Council, they have looked at some of the tools and some of the programs that have been developed at Wits University. So I think the final message that Joe has given us is that we can't afford to be complacent, and that children of all ages are at risk, and that our real challenge is still in translating knowledge and practice. And I just want to say congratulations, Joe. It's a privilege and an honor to have you know, stood alongside you, to have worked with you, and I think that I speak for all the people in the room tonight. And congratulations once again, and thank you everybody for coming tonight.
Thank you, Prof. Mayeswa. So at this stage, thank you to Prof. General for having chaired the session, Prof. Mayeswa for the vote of thanks, and most important, thank you, Prof. Potterton, for sharing your research with us. So I'd like to bring this this procession to a close again, but importantly to thank everyone that has made the time and effort to actually attend, those that have joined us virtually, colleagues of Prof. Joe, friends of Prof. Joe, students of Prof. Joe, and most importantly, family of Prof. Joe. Your attendance is highly appreciated. Thank you.